to take a seat. We're now going to have a video tribute, which is by Piers Hilton. So for those of you, who don't know, he's an American blogger and columnist and TV personality, and he's a bit of special message for this afternoon. Hundred hits a month, and in the last week since it's been announced that Dan's service would be here, we've kind of up in the 4,000 or 5,000 hits just gives you a little bit of a glimpse of the impact he had. Now, numbers can be flattering, but really, they have ever so little worth. But the impact that Dan had in terms of pushing forward research through painful personal exposure, encouraging those in despair and sometimes who are suicidal, giving a framework for life in the midst of suffering. I mean, how do you live when you're near the time of death? Keeping smiling, even when at times he was in the most terrible pain and situations. Living in the moment so that it absolutely counts. Being self-giving, pushing for greater understanding, better outcomes for both himself and others experiencing aggressive and fast-growing cancer. That impact, that really counts. That makes a difference. That's worth pushing for. Every life that was enhanced or helped or encouraged by Dan's relentless exposure of his personal experience and the impact that it was having on him and also Becca and family and friends, that counts. You know, from a Christian perspective, you get life once. And if this moment will never come again, then that begs a question, which is, what can I do to live it well, to make it count, to impact positively those around? And personally, I have a couple of things particularly to thank Dan for. Nando's. Dan bought me my first ever Nando's. So I kind of have a dream of Western becoming this kind of thriving, creative, arty sort of university town. And I know that young adults love Nando's. So when they opened Nando's at the end of the high street, I was desperate to go. And I kept kind of dropping hints to the young adults here at St. Paul's. None of them would take me to Nando's. I mentioned it once. It was booked. And I was hooked. Dan introduced me to Nando's. Dan, thank you. I shall remember you every time I have Nando's. And also, he introduced me to Vic and Morty. Now, I'm really not sure that Vicar should be watching Rick and Morty, but I've come to enjoy it immensely. It's my gym viewing, and on the treadmill, I think of Dan a few times every week as I crank it up and stick my earphones in and do my 25-minute run or whatever it is. I'm a little bit concerned that the gym staff think I'm losing it when I laugh out loud sometimes, but I think I also learn quite a lot about Dan from watching Rick and Morty as well. I also learned some other things, serious things, from Dan. And I just want to share three of those with you briefly. Firstly, living in the moment. I can't tell you how much it meant to me. I was in the gym, in the changing room, when I got an Instagram message from Dan saying, would you come to my wedding reception? I thought, what? I didn't even know you're getting married. You know, and to think that these couple could kind of arrange a wedding and get married in the space of 2 or 3 days, it was kind of crazy and beautiful, brilliant and bonkers, all at the same time. Becca looked absolutely stunning, completely fairy tale. And Dan, ridiculously happy for a dying man. You know, Jesus' teaching was, don't worry about tomorrow, because there are enough things for you to worry about today. Your Heavenly Father knows everything you need. So in effect, what Jesus was saying is exactly what Dan did. He lived the day fully, even if it means not doing life normally. Brothers and sisters, live life full, not normal. That's something I learned from Dan. Second thing was self-sacrifice. You know, Dan's chronicling of the impact of his cancer was exposing. There was a considerable cost to him and his family. And his approach to treatment and his willingness to trial and allow research, it was sacrificial. Dan's concern wasn't just about himself and living well the life that he had, but it was about others. He had a sincere hope that by doing what he could, he might enable, encourage, and push medical research forward, and that others would then have a better right than he did. Jesus once said of those who offered refreshment, as I said, and help to someone in need, whether they were known or a stranger, when you did it to the least of these, my brothers and sisters, you did it to me. Dan might not have seen the impact of his approach on so many thousands, nameless individuals, that he can't possibly have known, but Jesus knows the impact he's extraordinary. I think particularly in a society where resilience seems to be seriously lacking today. Life can be really hard, a series of obstacles to overcome at the best, or to learn to live with and work around, and it's really easy to be defeated and to give up. Ecclesiastes in the Bible says this: the race is not to the swift or the battle to the strong, nor does food come to the wise or wealth to the brilliant or favour to the learned. Time and chance happen to all. And indeed it does. And those who win are like Dan. They don't give in and they don't give up. Now, I don't know where Dan stood with Jesus towards the end. I know at different points in his life, his journey ebbed and flowed. What I do know is Dan wasn't keen on religion. And it's true that some religious type, whatever their religion, are ridiculously superficial and silly in the way they say things, and particularly in the area of health and healing. And they can be terribly insensitive and offensive. Some of Dan's blogs are uncomfortable reading for people like me. And some people would find them outrageously offensive in their bluntness. But I think Dan was nearer Jesus than you and I might think in that, because Jesus hated religion. He was outrageously offensive in what he said about the religious of his day. He called them whitewashed tombs. I.e. you look beautiful on the outside, but inside you're rotten. It's not very nice really, is it? At the end, that's why they killed him. Because he offended the religious people of his day by exposing them for what they were, hypocrites. And for me, that's part of what makes him such an attractive, supremely attractive man. He was truthful through and through. So I think Dan and Jesus actually have a reasonable bit in common in the hating of religion and a desire for truth in the inner being. I kind of think if they had met one day in hospital, in, you know, wearing one of those awkward hospital gowns, you know, the things with a big sort of gap at the back, they're terrible, aren't they? And I remember the first time I put one of those on, it was on backwards, but I wasn't quite sure which way to go. I kind of think if they'd met one day in the hospital, in a situation, I kind of think that Jesus would have liked Dan. And I think Dan would have liked Jesus too. You know, each of you will have your own view on what happens after death. Mine is based on the evidence in the scripture of Jesus' resurrection, which I find supremely compelling, and the attractiveness of the man as I read about him in the Gospels. So my hope is of a day when Dan will stand before Jesus in his own body, but a body free from cancer and all the pain and distress that he had to go through, and standing everything.